Lisa Miranda here with Faith Fitness. Welcome to class today. Everyone can sit up tall, roll your shoulders back. You can interlace hands if you want to. Take some deep breaths. We'll get started here.
Thank you.
6, starting in 48. Take a deep breath in. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that comes down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. Then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. He said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. On hearing it, many of his disciples said, this is a hard teaching, who can accept it? Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? John 6:63 says, the Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of Spirit and life. Turn your resistance. You can go heavier on this song if you want. It's another slower one. Lord, thank you that you make us hungry for you. Thank you that your Spirit helps us come and feed on what only you can give us, which is yourself. I am the bread. Help us feed on you in every area of our life, Lord. Help us come to you, not as a last resort, Lord, but because of who you are, the living bread that comes down from heaven. I am the living bread, he says. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Grumbling. The Lord had just brought them through the Red Sea. They started grumbling in Exodus 16. It would have been better for us to go back to slavery. And he hears them and he sends them manna. And they say, what is this? You must gather. Go out and gather what you need just for that day, but it's not going to last for the next day. You've got to go out again. Are you going to follow his commands and go out again? And the ones that didn't, they saw that they gathered more and they thought they needed it for the next day. But that rotted. He said, on the sixth day, you're going to gather for 2 days because I'm going to have you rest on the seventh day. But they still didn't listen. Now here Jesus says, just like he wanted to show and test, like I'm going to be your provider daily. Every day I'm going to provide for you. You know, he says, I'm the living bread. I'm alive. Feed on me. What are we feeding on today? What have you been feeding on this past week? I was gone for a few days and I could feel the It's like, Lord, I know you're with me. This has been busy, busy soccer days, inviting the living God into that, but I could feel that, just that difference. The words I speak to you, they are full of spirit and full of life.
In your life and mine. See,
See, sometimes things don't make sense when we follow Adonai. But man, whenever I look back, I'm like, whoa, okay. Yeah, that was a great idea. In the time, I was the chief grumbler. Biggest brag of all. Complaining, grumbling. What a merciful, merciful Father we have. Deuteronomy 8, verse 2. Remember how the Lord, your God, led you all the way to the wilderness these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. So even if you don't know the answer right now, and even if it feels blurry and unclear, can we give him our praise? Can we give him our praise that, like, the oxygen mask of this world is failing us, and we want to take it off, and we want to reach for heaven's oxygen mask, the true living life? Can we give him praise that there's a stirring in our heart to even be hungry? See, while they were in slavery, while you were in slavery, while I was in slavery, am in slavery, the Lord comes and he rescues us through the fulfillment of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Aaron was speaking with the whole Israelite community. They looked towards the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in a cloud. The Lord said to Moses, I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them, at twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. That evening, quail came and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, it is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. John 6:35 says, Jesus declares, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But what is it is the supernatural provision of God for his people from heaven. I am. My job is to feed spiritually, daily for your life. My job is to fill you spiritually, and nothing else can do that. I love the beginning. The Lord reminds me of when he first called me to himself. I was like that verse in Job. I have heard of you, but now I have seen you. Now I know you for myself. And I remember at the beginning of that season, it is kind of a question like the Israelites. What is this? What is this hunger rising up in me? What is this that's happening? And the Lord takes that and he shows you himself. He shows you how he can fill, only he can fill that void. So anyone even online today, is your soul thirsty? I thirst, it says in Psalm 42, for the living God, something that never dies, that's alive. My husband was joking lately. We're on our drive to California, and he looks at me, he's like, "You're looking sleepy. You want to talk about Jesus?" And he knows it wakes me up, and I go, "It's because it's alive. It's alive." It's funny, it really wakes me up. Let's just talk about the Lord. Lord, thank you that your word is alive and active. Thank you that we're celebrating that he is not here in the tomb, that he is risen, that is coming, and we await your coming now, Lord. The Spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you about chewing on me, feeding on me, drinking my blood, eating my flesh. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of spirit and life. The next verse says, yet some of you won't believe. Leave too, Jesus says to the 12. Simon Peter answers him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. First part of Revelation, Jesus is talking to the seven different churches and has different warnings and admonishments. And the last church, Laodicea, chapter 3, and he says, to those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person, and they with me.
Thank you. Hunger and thirst will be satisfied.
What if it's the gift that causes us to desire His words, His food, His drink? I have no claim to it. I just look back and I'm still here in new areas where I'm like, I don't know what you're saying. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't even know what you want right now. But what if we can recount His promises and His faithfulness? And we're like, well, you know what? You saved me there, so I know you're going to save me again. I know you're going to lead me. I know you're going to speak to me. And we begin to ask, what do you say about this, Lord? What does your word say? What do you want me to chew on about this topic? See, I look back and I can see how I did that, but in the moment, I didn't know that that's what He was doing in me. And like I said, what I have to offer you is very imperfect and, to be honest, very undeserving by performance standards. Testing, quote unquote, many a day that failed, many a day that fell short, many a day grumbling with unbelief, and yet His faithfulness, calling me in, giving me little bits of bread to chew on and to drink. And so even in my season now or in the future where I might feel uncertain about things, I can rely and know who He is, and I know that if He's making me hungry, He will feed me. So it's kind of like a paradigm shift here. I'm inviting us, myself right now included, to consider that we actually praise for the hunger, or we praise for any area in our hearts and our lives right now that actually feel like they're a disaster, they're spiraling, they don't know what to do. The praise, and then the seeking. He is faithful. In Matthew 9, Jesus says, I have not come to call the righteous, those were thought they were healthy, but those who know they're sick. He never shames or condemns, but you can bring that to his feet. Is there an area that you're not satisfied? You're disappointed in yourself, in someone. And I've often, the Lord is like, and now he's put on my heart a few times, disappointed in me. Holy Spirit, timing, whatever it may be. Are you satisfied with your relationship with Christ right now? Where he has you and you're abiding. The other day I told Miranda, I go, even though this feels like such a long waiting, I know I'm in his will because I'm abiding. I don't have a checklist of what it's going to look like, all these things, or did I do it right? It's like, I'm abiding. I can trust that I'm in his will. So are we satisfied in that? Are you satisfied in the will of God for waiting yourself? Can you be filled with that? The waiting is a learning. The waiting is a learning to rely and depend on you. We've been chewing on that word rely. I think I wrote it here. Satisfied with the ability of God, which leaves the mind at rest and undisturbed by doubt.
Such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope, that he will continue to deliver us as you help us by your prayers. Then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to the prayers of many. See, like Lisa said, we're both having some situations in our lives where we see God move, and then it's like, panic and control and lack of trust is rising up. And so I can be discouraged and say, well, I've learned nothing all these years, and it's just a failure and go to shame. But instead, I feel this like, okay, Lord, you want to go another layer deeper here. You want to go another layer in my spirit. See, because daily, you and I are faced, like, with that one thing, right? Maybe it's more than one, but you know, like, that one thing, it's like, ooh, it could get you in a minute, and it could get you off track. And it's like Lisa said, I'm just seeing it, like, Lord, I get to come to you. I get to say, what do you say about the matter? If you decide to stay quiet for a day, or a year, or five, whatever, that's on you. You're Adonai. You're the shepherd. Like, I get to come and trust him. You get to come and trust him. Lord, we just thank you for your mercy. Like, I'm like in this area, I'm the chief of sinners, Lord. Like, your grace is so beautiful and amazing. Like, I could never tell people, yeah, it was super easy and I just trusted God. And I was like, yeah, he's great and I believe him all fully. That's not my story. Lord, and your great love and your mercy and your faithfulness and your grace have pursued me, and you're pursuing everyone else too, Lord. And so, Jesus, we praise you. We praise you that we can have this kind of abiding because of what you accomplished on the cross. So we just bring you our worship and we just praise you. Thanks for joining us online.